All right, good evening, everybody. I hope everybody can more or less see the screen and or me. We asked the restaurant to remove these wooden pillars, but they didn't want to do that. So you can maybe like move your seat a little bit or whatever. All right, so the title of this talk is Effective Vegan Advocacy. And what I'll do is, if my mouse works, yeah, I'll say something very shortly, very briefly about myself. I'll talk about why it's important to be active. I talk about a bit of strategy to veganize the world. And then we talk about vegan advocacy. All right. So first of all, about me, I used to be for 15 years director of a vegetarian vegan organization in Belgium called EVA, Ethical Vegetarian Alternative. We have about 12 people in our team, 12 people on the payroll. I left the organization about a year and a half ago, and I'm doing stuff on my own now. I was tired of leading an organization, and I feel like freer by myself. And basically today I kind of travel the world, especially Europe, to talk. And we were having a vacation here, and also we went to the animal rights conference in California. And on the way back, we stopped. Our flight was there was a stopover in Chicago, and I asked Vadim if he wanted anybody to give a talk, and so here I am. So when I was leading an organization, I was talking to the people who eat meat, the end consumer, let's say. And recently, or a year and a half ago, instead of like talking directly to the people who eat meat, I now talk to the people talking to the people who eat meat. So I'm a meta-activist, okay? So I try to like help activists, advocates, to do it more efficiently, in my humble opinion. Because I see a lot of activists communicate in ways that I think like, oh my God. I don't know if you know some of those people who you think like, this is maybe not the best way to approach people. And of course, we all have our own strategies and tactics, and it's hard to say what works best because there's not enough research, but sometimes we can use common sense and we can say like this probably works better than this. So that's kind of my job. It's like kind of like figuring out what works, what doesn't work. I write about this at the blog veganstrategist.org. And I also work together with Melanie Joy, who I assume most people know. We have started a project called the Center for Effective Vegan Advocacy, with which we travel the world and we give talks and trainings, weekend trainings, on how to be a good advocate for animals. All right. So some things I always say before I start a talk, we have to remember that our intentions are the same. We want the same things. We want, I assume, a vegan world. We want things to be better for animals, I guess most of your motivation is, but also for the environment. So we want the same things, but our strategies or way to get there may differ. And we should be respectful of differences there. We should appreciate that people have different ideas about what's effective. We should always keep in mind that the intentions are the same. And I think it's important to discuss strategy because some things may work better than others. And we have limited resources, limited time, limited money, so we have to go where we think it works best and it saves the most animals or whatever you want to save. Okay. Some strategies, of course, may be complementary. And the last point here is that my talk and the things I do are limited to food. I mean, there's also like circuses and lab animals, etc. I don't talk about that. I talk basically about animals, farmed animals, and animals in food and vegan food, because 99% of the animals that are being killed for food. That's not to say the others are not important, but this is where like the meat of the matter is. Okay, all right. So why activism? Why is it important to be active? I think there's a mixed audience here of people who are already active, who are doing stuff, who are like organizing something or flyering or doing whatever. And I think there's also people here who are just vegetarian, vegan without being specifically active, right? So I want to make a distinction between what you eat and what you say, so to speak. If you are a vegetarian or a vegan, then you save a certain number of animals, mainly chickens. But if you are somebody who influences other people who then change their diet then you of course have a much bigger impact, right? So that's why it's really important to be in some ways active and to be a good advocate for animals. So another way of seeing this is that these two things are actually not the same. What you eat, this is a bit of a symbolic representation of the impact that you can have as a person. And the impact of what you eat, if you're a vegan, you save some animals. But if you talk in a very efficient way as an advocate to other people, you can potentially save many more animals. Because each time you convince somebody else to go vegan, you double your impact, basically, right? And if you're a celebrity, are there celebrities in the room? If you're a celebrity, of course, this relation is even more skewed because your impact can be like, I mean, some people have like 4 million followers on Twitter or on Facebook or whatever. Imagine when these people talk about veganism, what an effect they can have, okay? So another way of saying this is, and this comes actually from the Bible, what goes into your mouth is less important than what comes out of it. And with what comes out of it, I mean your communication. The way you talk about veganism, the way you talk about animals is much more important than what you eat. It's not to say that what you eat is not important, but this is where you can make the most difference for animals, okay? And that's not even all. I mean, there's another significant part, which is your money. If you have, for instance, maybe you have no time, but you have some money to share, you can give it to an organization, and that this organization can print flyers with that, distribute the flyers, and maybe in 1,000 flyers distributed, there's going to be one vegan. That's your impact. You have funded that. You have sponsored that. So that's also very important. So it's not just about what you eat, okay? And then something else I want to say about activism, it's a matter of balance. So your commitment to change the world, I would say, can be like, there can be a lack of commitment. There can be, like, you can be the vegetarian that says, like, I do what I do and this is my business and other people do what they do and it's their business and I'm not gonna like meddle with them. That's like here. And on the other side you have like the people who are like gonna take every opportunity and every non-opportunity to convince other people. I was like that for a long time. Like I was meeting somebody on a train and I was thinking like, how am I going to make sure this person is different after they leave me? Sorry, this is switching now and then. So that could be too much. So what we're looking for, I think, is like a balanced type of person who's like committed to change things, but who does it in a way that is really positive, etc. If you are here, then my message for you is, do you remember this movie from, I don't know, maybe already a couple of decades ago? It's a James Bond movie, License to Kill. So if you're on this side of the spectrum, if you're not very active, then I'd say you have a license to veganize, all right? It's perfectly fine if you have an opinion that you really believe in and that you can give a rational ground for, and that comes from empathy and love. I think it's perfectly fine that you have the desire to open other people's hearts and minds to that. Okay? It's not just a matter of choice. The matter of choice is like, if we say like, what are we going to paint the walls in here, red or green? That's a matter of choice, right? If we're talking about animals, eating them or not eating them, I mean, technically, legally, it is a matter of choice. But the one choice has much better arguments behind it than the other ones, right? So don't think that eating meat is a matter of choice. It is in a certain way, but it's not a choice like what color are we going to paint the wall in. It's a choice with very far-reaching consequences. Okay, this is better without the noise. So if you are on that side of the spectrum, if you like a person who like really goes in there and shouts and screams or whatever, I'm exaggerating a bit, remember that the public support for a cause is not that big yet. In the sense that how many vegetarians are there? A couple of percentages, okay? 97-98% of the people eats meat, right? So the higher your public support, the more aggressive I think you can be. If you have a lower public support in society, you have to be kind of careful. Like, and you can see like a spectrum here. Like, if you talk about murder and child abuse, everybody's against that. So you can, if you see that, I mean, you have to put people in jail, you have to do something, right? If you go lower, cat abuse, Cecil the Lion, or bullfights. These are things that a lot of the people are angry about. A lot of the non-vegan people are very angry about and frustrated about. So you can be really like adamant and outspoken about these things, and even about fur. But if you go lower down the spectrum, meat has limited public support. So I think you have to tread carefully there. Right? You can say, of course, you could say, like, I don't care what people think. I'm going to shout my truth. I don't think that's necessarily the best idea. I'll talk about that later. All right. So a balanced person, a balanced activist or a balanced advocate, they're aware of the time in our movement that we're in, how much public support we have at this moment, that some things are too radical today still, maybe. We're diplomatic and positive and convincing. We choose our moments. It's not like we're going to, like, talk about this at every point. Like at every meal when people are eating, for instance, it's not the best idea to talk about it then. Good food is really important. If you're like shy and you don't want to like interact with people, or you're not a very good speaker or talker, you can always like cook for people, which is like really one of the best things you can do, even if it's a bit labor intensive. To be tolerant and open, to be a good example is also very important. At least be a good example. If you don't feel like talking to other people, be a good example. Be a shiny, happy person that other people say like, oh, whatever they want, I want to have it, right? And think in terms of us, of we all together, not in terms of us versus them, right? It's not a fight of us versus other people. It's something that we all have to achieve together, right? Okay, so a bit of strategy. This is, for some people, this is a controversial part. I get a lot of criticism on Facebook and on my blog because I'm not saying the things that that a lot of people say. So I invite you to listen to this and to think about it with an open mind and to see if this is useful for you. But basically what we want is a vegan world, right? And this is a representation of a vegan world. This is a foodscape, a landscape made by food, and this is all vegetables. This is an American photographer called Carl Warner. And you see these are strawberries, and this is corn, and these are nuts and seeds, and this is bread. So it gives you an idea of a plant-based world, right? This is where we want to get. We want to get to a place where people eat plant-based foods, right? So we want them to move from eating meat every day to being vegan. But there's another thing that we want too. We want them, I think most of you would agree, we want them to do that for the animals, maybe for the environment, but basically for the animals. Not just because they have no reason or because their girlfriend is a vegan. We want them to interiorize the good reasons. And maybe you recognize this, but these are lightning bolts. And this means like we don't entirely like that. This is not enough for us. So Meatless Monday, not enough. Being a semitarian or a demitarian, not enough. Being a vegetarian, not enough because you eat still dairy and cheese. Being veganish, not okay because making exceptions is not okay. And even being vegan, for these reasons, is not okay. The only thing we want is vegan for the animals, right? Do you recognize that in yourself or in other people, that it has to be for the animals, all right? So what I'm trying to say is that any amount of reduction is okay, and any reason is okay. And with okay, I mean temporarily. I mean, I want a vegan world as much as everybody, as any vegan at least. But these things will get us there, and I'll try to show why. So for most people, going vegan looks like this, right? It's like something really difficult. I mean, you've all had the question like, what do you eat, right? So it looks very difficult to them. It's swimming against the stream. And if you doubt that, if you think that being vegan, no, it's easy to be vegan. Well, it's not even easy to become vegan. It's even difficult to stay vegan. We know from research that about 75% of vegetarians and vegans at one point returns to eating meat. That means it's still not easy to keep up the diet today. So it's still too difficult. There's different reasons, but one of the reasons is convenience. All right. Another reason is that the people fear that it's not healthy, etc. So what I want to say is increasing the number of vegans is not, I think, what is going to make the fastest difference. So let me explain why any reduction is okay. This is, do you recognize this? What is this? Yeah, what does this represent?
Grains.
No gluten-free, that's it. So you have the gluten-free phenomenon here too in America, right? And it's very strong. Okay, it's everywhere I talk, people know what it is, and it's coming up. It's in the last 5 years or 10 years, it has suddenly come up out of nowhere. So gluten, the new Al-Qaeda, right? So you know that there's two kinds of people who avoid gluten. On the one hand, there's these people like they cannot have any gluten or they die or whatever they do, right? They really are allergic or intolerant, they cannot have it. On the other hand, there's people who think they need to avoid gluten, right? They avoid gluten and they think it's good for them, and I'm not passing any judgment. Science says it's not really helpful for them. But what happened as a result of these people who think they need to avoid gluten and who are not so strict about it as the people who have to avoid it? Thanks to these people, the really gluten-free people, of course, all of a sudden have a much higher choice in products. Why? Because the second group, the group that like thinks they have to avoid gluten, is much bigger than the first group, right? So this woman who's a really gluten-free person, she's complaining a bit that it makes it very difficult in a restaurant to explain that she cannot have any gluten at all because there's all these fake gluten-free people around. But on the other hand, she says like, it's much more easy for me to eat gluten-free now. So what happened was that demand by a big group of fakers created a big choice. So compare this with the vegetarian vegan movement. We have a very small number of vegans. We have a much higher number, well, but still very small, of vegetarians. And we have a much higher number of meat reducers. These are the people that drive the change. If today it's easy for you to be a vegan, it's thanks to these people. And if you ask any people, any vegetarian business, who their prime target audience is, they will say it's these people. Not these people, they're too small. It's hardly worth catering to them. This is the group that interests them, because they're much bigger. It's like 30% of the population. So be thankful to this group. So what we need to do is also create this high demand and increase it still. Create a demand by a big group of non-vegans so that the supply follows and that it becomes easier for everybody to become and to stay vegan, right? So another way to put this is this, like if there's not enough alternatives, or if they're not available, if they're not quality, if they're not tasty, if they're not healthy or whatever, if the quality and the availability of the alternative is not very good, the effort that's required is very high, okay? Another way to say this is compassion costs too much. If you want to be compassionate for animals, it's still for most people, not for you, but for most people, it is still difficult. They have to go out of their way. It's not the default option to find vegan food, okay? What if we turn it around? If the alternatives are very high, available, good, the required effort to change, to make the switch, is lowered. Imagine, like, I'm here with a plane. You tell me, well, Tobias, the plane is very polluting for the environment. Now, if I don't want to, like, come here with a plane, can you imagine that I have to be very, very motivated? You know? I have to take, a long swim, or like I have to be on a boat for 8 days or whatever. So I have to be really, really committed for the environment if I take the boat and not the plane, right? Imagine that this is the only thing you could eat today as a vegan. Who would be a vegan today? Come on. Some people, right? Yeah, some people. Like maybe a monk, a Buddhist monk. Okay? But imagine that. Even the people who say like, yes, I would be a vegan, would they have gone vegan in the first place if that was the only thing available? I don't know. But then a couple of decades ago, we discovered like we can make legumes and we can combine pulses and legumes and we can make a tasty vegetarian dish and some homemade meat substitutes, and some more people go vegan. And then we made really good meat substitutes, tofurkey, etc., and more people go vegan. And maybe in 5 years we have the lab meat, indistinguishable from normal meat. You know, same taste, same price, same quality. I know somebody, some people think it's yucky, but I think for most meat eaters, they don't insist on having a dead animal on their plate. They just want a certain taste and a certain convenience and whatever, and bite. So still more people would go vegan. So the important thing is, like, increase the availability and the rest will follow. Compare this with this pole vaulter. We can tell her, we can talk to her, come on, you can do it. You can jump, you can break the world record, you can train harder. Or what else can we do here? We can lower the bar. Of course, in sports, it doesn't work like that. But you understand the metaphor, right? We can lower the bar. And we can lower it so much that going vegan maybe didn't require any motivation at all. What will you think about that? Not everybody would like that. You can't just go vegan for no reason, right? You have to do it for the animals, okay? So not all of us would like it. But here's the good news. Any reason to do it is okay. Let me explain why. In the drivers or the factors to get us to go vegan, we can distinguish the moral ones, animals mainly, also environment, and non-moral ones. Like, suppose it's available everywhere, a good alternative lab meat is available everywhere. People would do it for a non-moral reason. You understand? If you became a vegan because of your girlfriend, that's not a moral reason. I mean, that's like a relationship reason or whatever. It's not the moral, ethical reason to do it. Okay, so there's different kind of reasons. So we think, we in our movement, we emphasize the moral reasons very much. Why is that? One thing is because we think that works. We think that worked with all revolutions. Like, here is a pamphlet from the anti-slavery movement, abolition. And it says, like, 3 millions of your fellow beings are in chains. It's a moral argument, right? We have to liberate these people. But we forget that in the fight against slavery, there were other factors involved. What's this? This is a steam machine. And it was developed at that time. And the steam machine made it possible, in some cases, that automatic labor, machine labor, was sometimes cheaper than slave labor. Slaves had to be housed and had to be fed. That has a price. So sometimes this was cheaper. So can you imagine the impact this had? It's an economic, non-moral argument, right? So these things, we cannot forget the impact of these things. Now, why is every reason, whether it's moral or non-moral, is it okay? Why we don't have to really worry that it's about the animals? Well, usually we reason like this. We're going to talk to somebody, give them literature, and we hope that this literature will change their attitude, and as a result of that, this will change their behavior. They think, like, oh my God, yeah, I care about the animals, so now I'm going to change my behavior, I'm going to stop eating meat. That works sometimes, but it doesn't always work. You know that there's a huge gap between attitude and behavior, right? So, fortunately, it also works the other way around. We can influence behavior, and then the attitude changes. Okay? An example is this. When seatbelt laws were introduced, a lot of people said, like, oh my God, seatbelts, I don't want to wear them, this is annoying and I'm against it. But they had to wear them, because it was the law, right? So a couple of years later, after they were introduced, they asked people again, what do you think of this law? And most people said, yeah, good law. And they liked it. So what happened? For instance, they may have experienced that wearing the seatbelt wasn't that bad at all. Or they identified with, I am a person wearing my seatbelt now. And they were like reconciling their opinion with their behavior. So that's the way it happens. Your attitude can come after you do some behavior. This is not the way we usually think about making people go vegan. Okay? Another example, this is a bullfighter, this is a butcher. They do the same things. They kill cows, both of them. Who do you think most people, most non-vegans, are most frustrated and angry and annoyed with? This one or this one? This one, right? Why is that? There's different possible answers. Like most people say, like, well, this is about food and nutrition and they think this is necessary and this is about entertainment, or this is visible and this is invisible. But I think there's a more fundamental difference and a more fundamental reason to hate him rather than him. Can you guess based on what I was just telling? Mm-hmm. What is it? People are involved in this, but not involved in this. Right? So it's much more difficult to judge a behavior that you're doing yourself than something that you're not participating in. Right? So what happened is the behavior came first. You live in a country where this is not important. You're not involved in this at all. If you're outside of Spain or Mexico or whatever, you're not involved in this. You don't watch it on TV. You don't go to the shows, right? So it's much easier to judge this because you have no stake in it whatsoever. Okay? So usually the way we think about this is the more people care about animals, the more people eat vegan. But this also works. The more people eat vegan, for whatever reason, to whatever degree, because your girlfriend is vegan, because of health reasons, whatever, the more people will care about animals. This attitude may follow, it's not going to happen always, but often this attitude can follow the behavior. All right? Good. Everybody with me so far? Yeah. Then we'll look at some tips for vegan advocacy 101. So we want to get here, we want to get to the vegan world. It's probably the most difficult challenge ever for human society. This is like a huge fight. One of the reasons for that is that we don't have the animals to fight with us. In the women's liberation movement, black liberation movement, gay liberation movement, there's always the subjects that are fighting this fight, at least partly, but most of the time mainly. In our case, no help from the animals, right? Probably never going to happen. So how are we going to do this? I think we have to focus always on impact. So impact is not about telling it like it is. You know, like, oh, I'm going to tell them. This is like murder, and I'm going to tell them, and they have to know my truth, etc. But it's not about talking about what we want to talk about. It's not about winning an argument either. Winning an argument, we think that like winning an argument is very important. There's a saying from sales that says, to win an argument is to lose a customer. If I sell you a car and a week later the door falls off and you come to me and you say like, oh, I bought this car from you and the door falls off. This is like a piece of shit car. And I can show you like, look at the warranty. It's not covered by the warranty. And I win the argument, but I've lost you as a customer. You're not coming back to me, right? So we may win the argument, but people don't like to lose an argument. So sometimes it's even better like to concede an argument to them than to like really insist like, oh yeah, I convinced them. I had a few good logical points, and now they're convinced, they had to admit they were wrong, and now they will go vegan, right? It's probably not like that. Probably the relationship between you is much more important than whether you were right or wrong. So what is it about? It's about doing or saying stuff that makes people open to the cause, that makes them open their hearts and minds to our message. That's all we can do. We have to make sure we say things and do things that don't close them up further, but that open their hearts and minds. I think that's what we can do. And the most important skill for any person trying to influence anybody else to do something or to think a certain way is to put yourself in the other person's shoes. Okay? So I call this principle Yanya, and it says, you are not your audience. You are not the audience you want to reach. Those people that you want to reach are not necessarily the same as you, and you have to keep that in mind. So we make the mistake sometimes saying like, I became a vegan after watching Earthlings, and now I'm convinced that every person who watches Earthlings will go vegan, and if they don't, they're crazy. Okay? These people may be completely different from you. They may be differently wired. They may be not into animals. They may be not into whatever, you know? So there's many different ways that people are different. Let me give you a few examples to show how irrational people can be when it's about food. You know this guy? Jamie Oliver, he's like one of the most famous chefs. And he tried in Britain to introduce healthy school lunches. And what happened was that the kids in the school, they said like, well, I don't want these healthy school lunches. They just went out during lunch break and they got their junk food at KFC and McDonald's and Burger King. And so the school said like, well, this plan is not working. Let's make sure they can't escape during lunch break. We just lock them up. We just make sure they have to eat here. And this infuriated two mothers. They got so angry that what they did for 2 weeks was to go to the students, take down their orders through the fence of the school, said like, what do you want, a Big Whopper, a Big Mac, whatever, and they went to the local McDonald's and brought like 70 orders back each day. That's how they were insisting that their children had their junk food. I mean, can you imagine like reasoning with people like that? It's not probably not gonna work with like rationality, okay? Does anybody recognize this? This is the Heart Attack Grill in Las Vegas. And it's of course it's Vegas, but the burgers are called like the triple and the quadruple bypass burger. And the waitresses are running around like nurses. There was a guy at the entrance who greeted the people when they came in. You know, in America, you can do that because wages are much lower than in Europe. We never could do that in Europe. And he said, like, welcome to the restaurant, etc. And this guy was a very big guy, and he died from a heart attack. So this is funny and not funny at the same time. I mean, what I want to show is, like, people walk into these traps with their eyes open, and they still do it. Right? So a quote from a friend of mine is, like, forget telling people to go vegan to save the animals' lives. They won't even do it to save their own lives. Right? That's how irrational people are and how addicted we are to our food sometimes. Okay, so people can differ from us in many, many ways. Like they can be like more emotional than rational. They have different interests. They have been raised in different ways. So we have to remember people can be entirely different from us. Okay? So still, you can say like, I'm gonna bring my message and I don't care what other people think of it. I know a lot of activists who think that way. Do you know people who think that way? Like, I'm gonna speak my truth and we have to speak out and we have to tell our truth, etc., etc. I don't see the value in that in itself. I only see value when we speak a message that reaches people, right? I don't see value in like being bold and like speaking our truth and being brave, you know? I see value in having a message that people can understand, can relate to, and can lead them to change. So being bold or being open or being truthful or whatever is not in itself a virtue, in my opinion. Okay? So let's look at some examples as an exercise, like how would these things look if you look at them through the eyes of a non-vegan? Okay? So this is Bill Clinton who explains why he became a vegan. Does any of you have a comment on this article? Yeah, well, a comment, I don't know if he went back to eating meat, but in any case, he was eating fish now and then. And so some people react like to this, well, they can't call him a vegan because he eats fish now and then. But imagine, and this is like very controversial, but I can imagine that if a lot of people would see being vegan as something that is like not 100% thing, but a 99.5% thing, we would have so many more people changing their diet. Right. You know? If people would come to us and they say like, well, I can imagine myself going vegan, but just this one time when I'm for Christmas at my grandmother, she cooks this and I have to eat it. She's not gonna live much longer and I have to eat it. So I can't go vegan. What do you say to that? You can say like, well, you have to do it. Grandmother or not, you have to go vegan. Or you can say like, go vegan except for this one meal a year. Won't that be much more productive? Okay.
I think you sent some people over there to yell at their grandmother.
I beg your pardon?
Some people over there yell at the grandmother.
Yeah, I mean, you can yell at your grandmother and hopefully she has hearing problems. this is another example of an action. This is an action by Direct Action Everywhere. The idea was here to at the holidays, Thanksgiving and Christmas, to ask your family to make the vegan the holiday meal vegan entirely for everybody. And if they would refuse, you have to boycott the family meal. So this is again an exercise in trying to see what this would look like from their perspective, from your family's perspective. I think they would say oh my God, you're putting your ideology and whatever above your family, and I think you're going to alienate them. My opinion. I mean, I'm sure some people had success with it, but I think basically if you do something like this, if you boycott a moment that's really almost holy for your family, that you get the family together at, and then you say I'm not coming if you don't do it my way, is not going to be very productive. Although I think actions like these may be productive maybe in 10 years time or something. So that's what I mean. You have to always keep in mind the phase of the movement where we're at. Okay, what do you think of this? Some people are against these temporary vegan pledges. So this is Beyoncé saying let's go vegan for 21 days. And some people would say, what is this crap, 21 days? No, you have to do it. You have to do it for life. Every day. It's not just okay to not kill animals for 21 days, right? You have to do it every day. But look at it from other people's perspective. They would say, I think, oh well, this is not something I have to make a lifetime commitment to. I can try this. I can try this temporarily. I see what it does for me, and nobody will blame me if I don't continue it. Okay, this is the deal. You try it for 21 days. If you don't like it, you stop. I mean, we hope that people continue, but I think this is an attractive way to try something out. Okay? Again, think of this from other people's perspective. Slogans like these, I don't know if anybody uses them here. Meat is murder, dairy is rape. Most people will not feel attracted to you if you call them murderers or rapists. That's very simple. Basic human psychology. It's not appealing. If you call me something, if you accuse me of something, I'm probably not going to listen I'm not going to listen better to you. And again, if this changed you, and it could have, don't assume that therefore it will change other people. Okay? Same thing with the Holocaust. Shocking to a lot of people. Tricky. Okay? So, do you know this quote? Oh, no, this is my quote. But this is... probably you don't know it. But it's an allusion or a paraphrasing the famous quote by Jeremy Bentham. The question is not can they reason nor can they talk, but can they suffer? You know that quote? So my variation is, the question is not am I right, nor is this my truth, but does it work? So does it work is, I think, the most important question we can ask. Not am I true to my values or whatever. I mean, that's all nice, but this is what's important, in my opinion. Okay? So another tip is to be adaptive. We have a wonderful cause in the sense that we can link to our problem, we can link all kinds of solutions. We can talk about animals, environment, hunger, health, taste, culinary things. And it's important, I think, to look at what is of interest to the person in front of you and talk about that. There is no obligation to talk about animals all the time. Like I said, the reason is not so important. Everything may lead us to a higher adoption and the more people who do it who are vegetarian, vegan, part of the time, for whatever reasons, the more easier it gets for all of us and the more further we can progress. Okay? Also, be adaptive in the sense that you can give different things to people. Right? We don't have to necessarily give them information, blah, 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 the trees and the animals, blah, 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 all the things we know by heart, but the theoretical information. We can also give them practical information. In a lot of cases, people are much more interested in this. If you ask any organization, what are the most popular pages on your website, and this is something that they can track very well, what is it going to be, you think?
Starter kits and recipes.
Recipes, exactly. Recipes most of the time are much more important, much more visited than this like information, why should you be vegan? We think that this is what we want to tell them, right? But they're more interested in recipes, which is like, it kind of frustrates us sometimes because we want them to be interested in like learning why, but this is, it's a start. I mean, the recipes, again, it's the behavior first. They start cooking like that and then they start like, oh, now I'm gonna like, yeah, I'm, they can get more open to the arguments because they see it's not so difficult, okay? You can give them a taste experience, you can cook for them, you can give them a feeling. Like everybody we talk to, we leave with a feeling. And I think in life in general, it could be a good objective for any kind of interaction to make sure that people leave us with a better feeling than when they found us, okay? I think this feeling that people have, this interaction, is very important. That they don't think like, oh, vegans are nasty people or impatient people or preachy people or whatever, but they're really nice people. Okay? Thread lightly means that you're careful. So I call this the great vegan handicap. It consists of guilt and fear. People are, in a lot of cases, they feel guilty already about eating meat. They have some internal dialogue going on about eating meat because they know, even if they think that eating animals is technically okay, they at least will think that, well, it's not okay to eat whatever meat. They know that the animals suffer for the meat that they eat, okay? Most people think like that, but very few go out of their way to eat a certain kind of meat or whatever, so they don't put this into practice. So they feel guilty. And secondly, they fear some stuff. They are afraid of like losing their family and friends over their food. They're afraid of like not being able to invite friends over because they only can now make vegan food and these friends may not like it. So they may have health concerns. So all kinds of things are in their minds. We can laugh at them. We can say like, oh my God, are you afraid of like this or that while the animals are like fighting for their lives and suffering? But I would suggest not to trivialize these things and to respect people in these feelings that they have. So what I suggest is like, we can compare it to dating. So imagine that there's at your work, or I mean, imagine you're not married, and at your work or at university there is a girl or a guy or whatever who you are interested in. And you say like, well, I have this feeling that this could be the one for me, even you never talked, you never talked to her or him. I had a situation like that for 4 years. I thought that she was the one and never talked to her. So when you finally approach this person, you're not gonna say like, I wanna marry you and I want you to have my babies, right? Or I want you to have, yeah. So you're gonna like do this. You're gonna step into that, wade into that, okay? Step by step. That's, I think, the way maybe we should approach talking to other people about veganism. Not necessarily like, you have to go vegan tomorrow, or today, or yesterday. It's like, try this, try that, you know? Go to a vegan restaurant, invite them for dinner. Like warm them up to this, okay? So, the important thing is this from you or is this from Matt maybe? We need to help people make the first step rather than the last. It's not about the details first, it's about taking the steps. Step by step, we can get there. It's important to welcome everybody. So like I said, this is still the way it looks. People are afraid of this. It's like, it looks very difficult, but what do we do or what does our movement do often? With people who show interest, we say like, stop, are you vegan enough? Are you vegan enough to come to my side, to join our club, right? So sometimes my impression is that vegans want to be the smallest group in the world. So I looked up a picture of the world's smallest group and I found this Facebook group and it said like, this is the world's smallest group, I'm the only fan, if you join it, I will kick you out, right? Huh? This is real, yeah, I didn't make this up. But can you see like the relationship with our movement sometimes that like we're not really welcoming? We're just being very critical and like you cannot be here if you like, what shoes are you wearing, etc. So I would suggest like we welcome people. Be nice is very obvious. To put this another way, don't be a dick. These guys, they are the vegan bros. Have you heard of them? They're very good. They talk especially to like a male audience and like they say fuck every three other words. But they're like, they appeal to a certain audience and they say don't be a dick. They have really good messages if you can look over the profanity. So a nice vegan, I would say these are obvious things, to be kind and compassionate, to listen rather than talk all the time. To have a sense of humor is so important. You know, I think we can basically laugh at anything. To be open-minded, to be careful when judging, like to try not to judge, basically. Because people will think that we are judgmental already. They have this prejudice that we are judgmental, and we often are, basically. But we have to try not to come over as too judgmental. Okay, to be positive and not angry, and to be encouraging. Another point is don't make it too difficult. Don't make vegan seem like something that is feasible, okay? So we can, how do we make it too difficult? We can like be in a restaurant. I used to be like that. Like people ask you like what you eat, what you don't eat. And we're very proud. And we like make this long list. Like I don't eat meat, fish, eggs, dairy, honey. I don't wear silk, fur, blah, blah. And we go on. And like the longer the list, the more impressed with ourselves we are, you know? So that's probably, if you think again, from people's perspective, it's not very attractive, okay? Same thing, like if you're with people and you're like, or like at a dinner table, don't like start like can I eat this? And you know, what is it? I mean, take it to the bathroom if you have to and examine it there. But like what this does is not showing how great you are. It's showing how difficult veganism is, okay? So I met a vegan once who said he never goes out to eat because he doesn't trust anything. I met him at a vegan conference and he wasn't eating there. Okay? So not only it gives us like a very difficult idea of veganism, but also you don't give anybody, like this is not a vegan restaurant, but we are as a group giving this restaurant the opportunity to experiment. You know, and we're giving them customers, etc., etc. So it's very important. Don't be a level 5 vegan. You know this from The Simpsons? I'm a level 5 vegan. I don't eat anything that casts a shadow. All right? The vegan police, you know them, right? I have this meme that says, I'm so vegan, I don't even watch Kevin Bacon movies. Right? So the more difficult you make it, I mean, the less people are going to want to join us. So again, what you eat is your own consumption is not that important compared to the effect you have. And by eating and behaving a certain way, whenever you're in public, we're talking about this. You're having a certain impact on other people. So certainly let's not like focus, zoom in on this too much, you know, and then examine like all the details there. Like for instance, honey, like, to most, I'm not saying you should eat honey, but to most people, honey is like a healthy product, etc. And as soon as you hear like you also don't eat honey, you can lose them. So I never volunteer the information about honey. It's only when they ask, like I will say like, yeah, it's also an animal product and some bees and blah, blah, blah. But I don't volunteer this information. I think meat, fish, eggs and dairy, stop there, okay? Wine is another example. So, I mean, if we're going to say to people like wine may or may not be suitable and you can't know it if it's suitable or not, how difficult are we making it for them, right? So you could say like, when I don't know, you know the problem with wine, right? That it can be clarified with some animal ingredients which are not in the end product, which have been used to filter the wine. So you could say like, if I don't know, I don't drink it. My idea is like, if I don't know, I drink it. Okay? I think vegans have an ethical duty to drink wine because we give a better idea of vegans if we do that. We don't present ourselves as monks, etc. All right? I'm just kidding. I mean, drink what you want. But I think it's not too bad if you drink wine now and then. All right. So This is a book that's called Veganissimo, A to Z, comprehensive guide to identifying and avoiding ingredients of animal origin in everyday products. And here it says, Veganissimo, one who is vegan to the highest possible standard. Right? I think this is a book that should never have been written. It has hundreds of pages like this. Right? Ingredients that are possibly of animal origin. So imagine, like, your friend asks you, like, can you help paint my room this weekend? And you have to say, like, well, can I see the paint first? I have to look at the ingredients to see if I can help you or not. This is not going to, like, give a very good idea of veganism. Okay? These are details, and I think the most important thing is these details will be solved by itself. If we take care, if the meat and the fish and etc. disappear, these byproducts will have to disappear too. So these are not our main concern. Okay? So we don't want people to react like this, right? Like, what is this? Is there like a sect or a cult or, you know? We have to be reasonable about this, I think. Okay? And we have to encourage every step. So we can tell them, go vegan or die. Or we can say, like, this is like Dutch. I mean, these are the days of the week in Dutch. So we can tell them, like, in Belgium, we have a campaign Thursday Veggie Day. So that's what we say, like, go veggie on Thursday. We can tell them, like, oh, okay, also take the Monday. And we can always tell them, like, oh, you're already doing this. Take one step further. Like, so people who are doing 2 days, we can tell them, like, be a semi-vegetarian. Half of the week, you are vegetarian. Or be a weekday vegetarian. Like, you allow yourself to eat whatever you want in the weekends, but in the week, you are vegetarian. Or you can say, like, make Sunday your meat day, you know, and all the rest is vegetarian or vegan. Or be a vegan before 6, you know, that system, like, by Mark Bittman. I think it's a really smart way of going at it. And, you know, so I don't know if there's people in the room like that, but some people find this message highly unethical that I'm giving now, because they say, like, we cannot, like, tell people that it's okay to partly eat animals. We have to always say that it's wrong. And it's speciesist if we don't say it like that. But imagine, I mean, if we really think about it like that, what would you have to do when you see people buying meat in a supermarket? You have to go and beat them up, right? Or you have to, like, prevent them from doing that. And that's not possible. Why don't we do that? Because everybody is eating meat at this point. So we have to be, we cannot, like, just go out there and say, like, you have to stop it now, and I'm going to prevent you. And I was in a national park, and there was all these people, like, fishing, like, anglers, right? And I mean, if I really think about the argument about speciesism, then you think, like, well, if they were doing this with people, this would be wrong. So they're doing it with fish. If I don't want to be a speciesist, I have to, like, kick their butts, kick them all in the stream, you know, and break their tools. But that's not what we're going to do, right? I mean, because we understand that there's a difference, that there's, like, a long way to go. Maybe in 10 years' time, or maybe, like, when 70% of the people is like, on board with us, then we can start using tactics like that, maybe, but not now. All right. So, and then you can ask people, like, to go vegetarian or vegan all the way, or you can say, like, try it for a week, try it for 2 weeks, try it for 3 weeks, you know, this 21 days, and see how it goes. Or we can say, and Joe will like this, you can say, like, pick an animal that you won't eat anymore. This is another way of, like, structuring your change of diet. So we can say, like, let's cut out the chicken, and Joe, I'll give you the honor, like, why should we cut out the chicken first?
Oh, that would spare 24 out of the 25 farmed land animals the typical person eats each year.
Did you hear? So most people, most animals that we eat are chickens. Fish also, but chickens is, like, because they're much smaller than cows, right? So there's for every cow, there's, like, the meat of 250 chickens inside of there. So we kill a lot. We let a lot more animals suffer when we eat chickens rather than cows. So if you would say, like, if a person would ask, like, what should I change first? What animal? Like, I care about animals, but I don't want to, like, give them up completely. I want to give up one animal. Tell them to give up chicken, because they suffer most, and there's very many of them. Okay. Or you can say, like, to some of these people who say, like, I could be vegetarian or vegan, but I still want to eat this or that. You just tell them, like, yeah, have some days where you eat that. If you really can't abandon that, if it's really so important to you, like, socially or whatever, Just eat it and be vegetarian, vegan for the rest of the year. And this is a wonderful victory. It's much better than those people doing nothing, right? And I'm sure that in due time, these people will say like, oh, why I'm still eating like, it was like that for me. Like when I started to be vegan or vegetarian first, there was a dish that I really liked and I had it like 2 or 3 times a year. And people said, of course, to me, oh, you're inconsistent, blah, blah, blah. But after a while I gave it up, was no problem because it wasn't fitting with me anymore, but I grew into it gradually. Leave dogma at the door, it means like, so I say it like this, there's no moral obligation to present veganism as a moral obligation. Does that make sense? So some people say like, we have to talk about veganism as a moral obligation for the animals. I don't think you're morally obliged to talk about it like that. I think if there's any moral obligation, it's the obligation to do something that is impactful. Not to adhere to some kind of like dogma or some kind of philosophy about advocacy that is maybe not the most helpful there is. Okay? So instead, rather than telling people they're obliged to do something, say like that they have a choice. A choice is much more attractive to people. If you say to people that they have to do something, if you say they have to do this, they have to eat this, then they are thinking like, oh, there must be other options that are much more interesting that I can't have. So let's look at these options, right? So it's not attractive. If you present something as you have to do it, not very attractive, okay? And also people don't like to be told what to do. It's like we're all adolescents in that way, right? Adolescents, like their parents tell them like, no, you can't do this, and then they will do it just to tease you, right? That's how a lot of us are. If you look inside, we all have that behavior still. Like if somebody tells us like, do this, then like, I'm just not gonna do that, you know? Choose your battles wisely means like, look at the situation, look at the person, and see if it's worth your time, okay? So this person, I mean, we cannot be prejudiced, but at first sight, this person would not be the person like worth like investing an hour of your time in, okay? Again, maybe prejudiced. On the other hand, there's like this a chef who's like responsible for the meals of like maybe 1,000 persons a day, and he's responsible for what they eat, so he's really interesting to talk to, because he's an influencer, he's a multiplier. So focus on these people first, all right? Listening is really a very important skill. It's like, we haven't, I don't know how it is in America, but we haven't really learned to really communicate with other people. Really communicate. I mean, we've learned language, etc., but to really communicate, we haven't really acquired those skills in school, I think. For instance, do any of you know nonviolent communication, like the system by Marshall Rosenberg? So that's a system that wants to teach you like how to communicate with each other. And one of the basic elements of that system is you're always going to look for needs. What is it that the other person needs? In a conversation, there's always something that they may be angry or they may be whatever, but there will also always be a need under that. And you're going to try to find out that need and you're going to try to honor that need. Probably it's something like they want to be heard, they want to be understood. And if you don't think about it, you're like really fast, like when there's an argument with your husband or your wife, you're probably going to like be defensive right away. But if you can remember to think about that need of the other person and also remember your own need, it's so helpful. Okay? So listening is part of that. So listening to what kind of need could this other person have? So this is a wonderful quote, I think, from Dale Carnegie. Of course, you are interested in what you want, but no one else is. The rest of us are just like you. We are interested in what we want, right? People are interested in what they themselves want. Have you heard of Dale Carnegie? Yeah. How to influence friends and how to make friends and influence people? It's like an incredible book for whoever wants to have an impact on somebody else. It has a lousy title, but it's a really good book. Another tip, do you know what vegan amnesia is? Can you guess?
Yeah, you forgot that you were before you became vegan.
Very good. Yeah. So you forget that you were ever a non-vegan. Have you met those people? Like they seem to like think that they have been, some people have been vegan for their whole lives, but most people haven't. But some of these people, they think that they have been vegan for their whole life. And they think that like they became vegan right away when somebody said the word vegan and they were convinced. Most of the time it didn't happen like that. Okay, most of the time it's gradual. But some of these people, they were very gradual, but they demand from other people that they do it right away. It doesn't make sense to me. Okay? So vegan amnesia is like forgetting that you were once a non-vegan. Okay? To be modest means that you confirm that you don't know everything. There are still doubts and questions within this movement and philosophically, etc. I can put dilemmas in front of you that you will have to seriously think about. It's not all cut out and black and white. Okay? So it's important that when you show to people that you don't know everything, they will be more likely to trust you than when you pretend you know everything. Ironically. Okay? When I voice some doubts here about my own theories, you will have more faith in me rather than less. Okay? So admit your own imperfections. This is also something like you know, this whole veganism is the moral baseline thing. I think that's it's kind of dangerous. And it puts ourselves on a pedestal and we say like, we're vegan, we have reached the moral baseline. And all of you who are not vegan, they have not reached our stadium or level. But all these people could be doing great stuff for animals, for the environment, for other people. I'm not going to judge a human rights activist who's not vegan or somebody who's a shelter who's not vegan. Well, I'm vegan, you know, and I'm not going to tell them like, well, you're not at my level, you haven't reached a moral baseline. They may be doing much more than I'm doing. Okay? All right. How much time do we have?
9:30.
Huh? Past the time. Yeah, so maybe I'll just tell them to you and you can think about it in your bed at home. Okay? So these are some unvegan thought experiments. So this is a purity test. You are, another person has invited you, they're a non-vegan. They have, for the first time in their lives, they have cooked a vegan meal, they have gone to the store and bought for the first time in their life vegan margarine and vegan minced meat and vegan whatever. And you sit down to eat and all of a sudden you discover that the lasagna sheets, the pasta, it has eggs. What do you do? Do you say like, sorry, I can't eat this? Or do you just swallow it? I'm only asking the vegans, of course. All right, so that's one thing to think about tonight. Another question is, would you eat a steak for $100,000? Let's see, who would do that?
$100,000.
The idea is, of course, to give the money to an animal rights organization, right? So who would do it now?
Lab raised.
Huh?
Lab raised.
Lab raised?
Yeah, lab raised. Lab grown.
Okay, yeah. Well, I'm talking about normal meat. Another example, again for the vegans among you. So there's a friend coming to eat in your town and or somewhere. You are somewhere and there's a restaurant and that's the only opportunity to eat. And they have two things. They have a very nasty vegan burger that you know is not really good, and they have a very tasty vegetarian burger. What are you going to recommend? The vegetarian or the vegan burger?
Vegan, sorry.
The bad one?
Yes.
And even though you know they will never eat vegan again after this lousy experience?
When we get into the Q&A, we'll
talk. Okay, yeah. So that's, these are experiments meant to raise this kind of questions. Can you imagine that some people might be more successful as non-vegans than as vegans in advocating for animals?
Sure.
Can you imagine that?
Yeah.
Because maybe people could identify more with non-vegans, right? We have a very successful vegetarian pledge type of thing. There's a girl who started it, and she does it every year, and she gets like I don't think there's any bigger pledge, and we are a small, very small country, but she gets 85,000 people to participate in 40 days without meat, it's called. The 40 days of Lent before Easter, Catholic thing, but it's not for Catholic reasons, but that's the, like the framing. And she's not a vegetarian. And her PR people have said, like, she wanted to give the campaign to us, a vegetarian organization, but her PR people told her, like, don't do that. The strength of this campaign is exactly that the message comes from a non-vegetarian. That people can identify with her and that they're not thinking like, oh, here's another vegetarian telling us from on high what we have to do, right? And this we have already got this. I could go vegan, but I really want to eat my bacon and eggs once in a while. You know, my answer, like if they're really, I mean, first of all, you could tell them like there's really good substitutes. There's like we have now vegan bacon and, well, eggs. Yeah, we have something that, that we have tofu, right? But if they're really insistent, I would tell them rather like eat that and go vegan for the rest of the day, of your days, and make these exceptions rather than do nothing. And of course, we hope that they will progress from there on. And the final one, I think this is a meme. Stop trying to make excuses. There are no good ones to make. Go vegan. It's very easy to believe this. There are no good excuses not to go vegan. A story I heard once was from a woman who said, I want to go vegan, but if I do that, my husband will beat me. She was in an abusive relationship. She could not every day bring vegan food on the table. I think that's a pretty good excuse not to go vegan at that point.
I mean, it's a good excuse to kill him.
Huh?
It's a good excuse to kill him.
Of course, you can say, like, well, she should leave her husband, but I mean, that's easy for us to say, right? So I think always try to remember that you don't know people's situations, that you don't know everything, that you don't know how they are, who they are, etc. So there may be good excuses sometimes. So be compassionate in that sense. All right, this is another part. It's online somewhere if you want to see this sustainable activism. But I'll stop here so that we have some time for questions and answers. So my blog is veganstrategist.org, and there's on the video page there's two. There's this talk split into two talks, a bit more elaborate, if you want to see that. And my blog posts are meant to, like, often, like, they're meant to make you think outside of the box, let's say.